So good morning all of you, and welcome back to Excelsure Academy. So in the previous lectures, we talked about P-type, V-type, F-type transporters, and regarding our MCQ, there was one mention of the transporters called ABC transporters, right? So today we are going to study about the ABC transporters in detail. So let's talk about ABC transporters. So what does ABC stands for? It stands for ATP binding cassette transporters. Okay, so this we'll understand by taking the examples of the ABC transporters. So they are widely distributed in all phyla. So what does it mean? It means that it is present in all, that is all eukaryotes, prokaryotes, in all the phyla, in all the phyla, that is almost everywhere it is present. Okay, so present everywhere. So it is present everywhere. It means every living organism have got the ABC cassettes. Now it consists of two transmembrane domains. Okay. And each transmembrane domain has got six membrane spanning alpha helices. So 2 × 6. So total 12 alpha helices we have. Okay. Now they are specific to their substrates. So till now, whatever we have discussed, each channel is specific to their substrates, right? Now, it also possesses two nucleotide binding domains. So remember in the question, so which nucleotide they are talking about? Of course, it is ATP. Okay. So they have got the two transmembrane domains below which they have got the two nucleotide binding domains. So that's how your ABC transporters looks like. Now, they are present in prokaryotes and they work as importers and exporters. So it means that in organism they can take the solute and they can also throw out the molecule. Okay, so both taking in, importing or exporting the molecules, both function is present in case of prokaryotes. Okay. Then, whereas in the case of eukaryotes, they act as exporters only. So what does it mean? Exporters, it means always throwing out. Okay. From the cell, in the case of eukaryotes, the ABC transporters, they are always meant to throw out of the system. So what molecules like? Ions, sugars, peptides, phospholipids, vitamins and polysaccharides. They're also involved in RNA translation and DNA repair mechanism. So when we start our MOL bio, molecular biology, wherein which we study about the replication, transcription and translation, there we'll also study the role of these ABC transporters in the case of RNA translation and as well as in the DNA repair mechanism. Okay, so far so good. So in the case of prokaryotes, it acts as both importers as well as the exporters. Whereas in the case of eukaryotes, it acts as only exporters. Now, look at the structure over here. So, already mentioned that it has got two transmembrane domains, correct? So, it has got two transmembrane domains. And each domain has got six alpha helices. So, you can see that N-terminal is here. You have got the six alpha helices. Then there is a NBD. What is NBD? It is nucleotide binding domain. Okay. So which nucleotide is binding in this case? It is the ATP. Then we have got another transmembrane domain. Again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 alpha helices are there. This is your second NBD and then the C-terminal. So clear? Now, if you see the structures over here, if the structure is clear, let's see how it functions. So what is the first step? That your molecule, the substrate which needs to be transported, goes and binds to the binding region. Okay. Then two ATP molecule comes and binds to the NBD. So you can see that the NBDs are present far away. So once ATP goes and binds to the NBD 1 and 2, what happens? The transporter which was kept like this, it is brought like this. So the molecule bind over here down NBD domain is there to which your ATP binds. So when this binding happens, both the domains come together. Now this results in the conformational change. What happens? The ABC transporters opens up like this, and the molecule is transported to the other side. See over here, the moment ATP is bound over here, both the domains come together. There is a conformational change from 1 to 2 and your molecule has been transported. Now once it has been transported, what happens? Then it again comes back to its original state. Okay. I hope this much is clear. Stop me in between if it is not clear. Now, more complicated structure. So slowly we are learning. So in this case, if you see the figure, you can see that. See, one transmembrane domain is meant for export. The second one is meant for import. Okay. So now we know why there are two transmembrane domain. Now see over here. So you have got the coupling helices. What does it mean, coupling helices? It means that whenever there is a conformational change, it has to be coupled with the binding of the ATP. Okay. So the moment ATP goes and binds to the NBD, it is coupled with the transmembrane domain, which results in the conformational change. Hence the molecule from in to out or out to in is happening. Okay. Now, what is the signature motif which gives you the idea that this particular transmembrane domain is your ABC transporter? It is this. Where is my, okay. So what does it stands for? Leucine, serine, glycine, glycine and glutamine. Okay. I repeat it again. Leucine, serine, glycine and glutamine. Okay. So we learn the short forms of the amino acids also once we start the biomolecules. So just remember over here, this is the signature motif for your ABC transporters. Okay. And then you can see that over here, the ATP is binding. Okay. Now this region is nothing but your NBD region. And this particular coupling helices, what they're talking is over present over here. Okay. So this much is enough for you to remember how exactly ATP goes and binds, how it is coupled with the transmembrane domain, and hence the molecule from in to out or out to in has been transported. Okay. So is it clear? So I'll just move on ahead. If any doubts are there, please stop me. Now the examples of ABC transporters. So this I have mentioned once, that all multi-drug resistance transporters are belonging to your ABC transporters. Okay. Now MDR1, this is one example. Now it is also called a P-glycoprotein. Any idea what does this P stands for? Glycoprotein, we know it has got a sugar moiety present on your protein, right? So if this is the plasma membrane, we have got protein present over here, correct? And then we have got the sugar. So this becomes your glycoprotein. But what do you mean by P-glycoprotein?
Phosphate?
No. Here, P stands for permeability. Okay. So in case of MDR, P-glycoprotein, P stands for permeability. So they are found in intestinal epithelium cells, capillary endothelial cells of blood-brain barrier, hepatocytes, etc. So you know what is blood-brain barrier, right? I hope everyone knows what is blood-brain barrier. So it is a barrier which prevents the passage of any molecules into the brain. Okay. So only regulated molecules such as glucose, which is required in high amount inside the brain, will be passed, or the oxygen. Okay, so it has to cross these blood-brain barrier, and so many regulations are there. So we'll study all those. Hepatocytes are your liver cells. Okay, now what is the main function of MDR in the case of eukaryotes? It is associated with the secretion of steroid aldosterone and transport of phospholipids and cholesterols. They also transport drugs such as colchicin, vinblastine, quinidine, etc. So can anyone tell me colchicin? Where else we have heard of colchicine and vinblastine or quinidine? Colchicine is a very common drug known. Anyone? Ranjan? Akshita? Anyone can give me the answer. Not necessary whose name I have taken, they have to answer. Yes, Sandhya? Yes, Ranjan? Where we have heard about colchicine?
Metaphase stage.
Metaphase stage, but doing what? Yes, you're nearby. So what does it do?
To produce seedless foods, ma'am.
One second, one at a time. Yes, Ranjan?
It increases the DNA content.
No.
Like 2C to 4C.
Ha, but how it is doing? How? Yes, anyone else? So, Ranjan, what you said is correct, but this happens because it actually... Have you heard of microtubules? Have you heard of microtubules? What are microtubules?
Yes.
Or microtubules or spindle fibers. Right? So during our mitosis, these microtubules which are there, holds your chromosomes. Okay? They are blocked. Okay? So they are not able to separate. And it inhibits your mitosis. So it's kind of an inhibitor of mitosis, and due to which you get from 2N to 4N. Okay. So that is one kind of drug. So usually when this function was known, many people, many doctors and scientists thought of treating cancer by using colchicine so that they can stop the growth of the rapidly growing cancer cells. Now the vinblastine, someone has said that it is used to treat cancer. Yes. So we have got vincristine and vinblastine, and they are used to treat cancer. But nowadays, even that is not functioning. Okay, then we have got quinidine. So it's a drug which has got similarities to treat malaria. Okay, so whenever you take all these drugs, so they can be transported with the help of your MDR. So your multi-drug resistance transporter. Now, tumor-expressed MDR are frequently resistant to chemotherapeutic agents and thus difficult to treat. So, what is happening in the case of tumor cells? So, in the case of tumor cells, whenever these MDRs are present, so they do overexpression. Overexpression means they are producing large number of molecules. So, instead of having 3, they might have around 10. So, whenever we give any chemotherapy, okay, so what will happen? They might take the drug inside, but they will also expel out. And because of which, what will happen? Then they are not, the chemotherapy drugs are not able to treat the cancer. They are not able to kill the cancer cells because they overcome all this by using the MDR receptors. Okay, clear? Now, these are the mechanisms by which a tumor survives, out of which one is the usage of MDR. So what are the mechanisms? First mechanism is not to take the drug itself. So how it can do? So even if you have got high concentration of drug outside, so we try to make drug. As a scientist, we try to make drug which are permeable to plasma membrane. Agree? Because I can't wait or I can't depend on the transporters so that the drug can go and bind to the transporters and then the transporters will take inside the tumor cells. So I need to make a drug which has to be hydrophobic in nature so that whenever there is an increase in concentration outside, that is extracellular, the drug can easily diffuse inside the cells. Okay. So now what will happen is, first mechanism is the cancer cells will try to decrease the uptake of the drug. Okay. Second is increase the drug metabolism. It means what? Inside the cell, they overexpress the enzymes. Like they are also called the detoxifying enzyme. they actually cleave the drug into two or three fragments, because of which what will happen? Your drug loses its capacity to kill the cancer cell. Okay, they are fragmented. So that kind of enzymes, they increase. This is first. Second, then the third mechanism is alter the drug targets. It means what? If suppose I have designed a drug in such a way that it goes inside the cell and kills the DNA pol of cancer. Okay. Let us say assume. Okay. But the cancer cells are so smart enough that what they will do, they will change the target. So if I make a drug which is specific to kill the cancer cell DNA pol, the cancer in return will alter the structure of the DNA pol. So now what will happen? Now my drug will not be able to recognize the DNA polymerase. Okay, so they alter the drug target itself. So they undergo mutation. So we also know that the tumor cells undergo mutations continuously. Now next. So this was the third. Now fourth mechanism. Impair the apoptotic pathway. So we know whenever something goes beyond the cell cycle checkpoints. Okay. So what happens is cell understands. Okay. That it is not in its own control. So they give a signal of suicide. That is your apoptotic pathway. But in the case of cancer, the proteins responsible, those are called pro-apoptotic proteins. Okay, so these are the pro-apoptotic proteins like BCL, BATS, BAD, all these are the proteins which are actually responsible to carry out your apoptosis. Now, what the cancer cell will do? It is going to decrease expression of the pro-apoptotic proteins. And then what will happen? Even though the cell has got so many cellular functions impairment, still the cell is going to survive. Because cancer cell doesn't want to do any function. It just wants to grow and reproduce. So it doesn't carry out any specific functions. Okay. Then we have got the alter the cell checkpoints. It means what? So in the cell cycle, from one phase to another phase, we have got the checkpoints. It means it will check whether the cell is undergoing the proper regulation or not. If something is wrong, it will repair. If it is beyond repair, then it is going to go under apoptosis. So in the case of cancer cells, they also overcome these checkpoints. Then last is the efflux pumps, that is your MDR. So whatever the drugs are there, they throw out. So you can see that it's not only one mechanism by which your cancer cell is actually surviving. So many mechanisms are there, and that's why it becomes very difficult to treat cancer. And on to top of that, it's not only one cancer we have, starting from your hair till the toe, nails, you have got different types of cancer. So when I was working on pancreatic cancer during my doctorate, so the first question was asked to me was like, which type of pancreatic cancer you're working? So I got confused. I was like, okay, again, in the case of pancreatic cancer, there are types are there. So you have got the endocrine and exocrine pancreatic cancer. Under endocrine, you have got another four types. Exocrine, you have got the another six types. So you can see that under one specific heading, pancreatic cancer, there are so many subheadings. And then each one has got its own mechanism of survival. And then you need to study that, then design your drug in such a way that becomes specific to treat that particular cancer. Okay, so this is just one example of pancreatic cancer. We have got many, many are there. So many are there that out of which we haven't heard of the names also. Okay, so all these tumor survival mechanisms are clear to everyone. And how this MDR is playing a role in its survival? Is it clear? Akshita, is it clear? Okay. So this is the mechanism now, like how exactly it is happening. So what you can see from here is that, as already mentioned, you have got your MDR, okay? So in this case, in the figure, you can see that it's have not shown two different membranes, two different transmembranes, they are shown together, okay? So all your 12 helices are there. Now you can see that there are two ATP binding molecules are there, which goes and binds. So one and two are there. Now the molecule has been transferred out. Now, so how many times, even if it comes because of your passive diffusion, again it will take the ATP and it will throw out. So this keeps on happening. Now this is in the case of, if you have got this passive diffusion of the molecule. What if the molecule is membrane bound? Okay, so even if it is a membrane bound, we have got a, see what happens, it comes through the membrane, but it is not good for the survival of the cell. So what it will do, it will take this and enter into the MDR protein. PGP means P glycoprotein, right? Remember I have mentioned. So with the help of the flip-flop, that is, again, it will make use of the flippase and floppase, and you take inside and it will throw out of the cytosol. Okay. So even if it is a polar or non-polar or membrane bound, it is able to take the molecule and throw out of the system if it is not required. Clear? So this is how your MDR or ABC transporters works. Now this is second example which comes under ABC. So in the MCQ, we have discussed about the CFTR, that is cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. So now we know after doing the MCQ that it is your chloride channel, right? So we know that it is your chloride channel in vertebrates. Now mutant CFTR affects the chloride channel, that leads to dysregulation of epithelial fluid transport in the lung, pancreas and other organs, resulting in CF. What is CF? Cystic fibrosis. Now what you have to understand over here is that, I think I mentioned also, when we inhale, it's not only the oxygen which goes inside. Along with our inhale, so many organisms, so many molecules also are taken inside. Now it is the responsibility of our airway tract, which is lined with the cilia, releasing the mucus. It is their duty or responsibility to trap all these unwanted molecules, and then they will be beated outwards. Okay. Only the oxygen should go inside and rest all should be expelled out. Now, once you don't have chloride channel functioning, what happens is this mucus becomes thick. There is no removal of the mucus, because mucus also needs to get replenished, right? It needs to get exchanged. So when this mucus is not getting exchanged and it is present over there, what happens? The respiratory tract keeps on producing the mucus and it becomes very thick. It becomes so thick that there is no passage, no free passage for breathe in. And that's why it becomes difficult in breathing. Okay. So let's see how it is being done. So complications include thickened mucus in the lungs with frequent respiratory infection. So when you have got mucus, all kinds of pneumonia, respiratory infections, fever, everything you start getting. And the pancreatic insufficiency, giving rise to malnutrition. And when your pancreas is not functioning properly, of course you get the diabetes. So on top of it having a respiratory problems, you also get diabetes. So all these leads to chronic disability and it reduces the life expectancy. So you can see that there are many people who actually always, you know, they put a pipe like this. And then they actually move with the cylinder. For example, in the case of this recent movie, you must have seen Dil Bechara, where Sushant Singh Rajput and the other heroine is there. She always carries a cylinder, oxygen cylinder. So one pipe is there. Mm-hmm. That is her oxygen pipe. So like that, same thing happens with the CF patients also. So they need to, wherever they go, they need to carry their cylinder. So it becomes very difficult because the cylinder is also heavy and you have to totally depend on that. So while doing anything, you just need to keep that pipe always. Okay, so this is how your chloride channel, the CFTR looks like. So you can see that again, it's coming under the ABC transporters. right? So it has got your 6 alpha helices over here and 6 alpha helices over the another part, right? So alpha, alpha, 6 and 6 are there. Now you can see that there is one NBD domain and second NBD domain, as we saw in the previous case also. Only one difference is that it has got the R domain. Now what is R? R stands for regulatory domain. Okay, so whenever there is a ATP binding, the regulatory domain undergoes in such a way conformational change that the channel gets open up. Okay, so it is actually a chloride channel. So once ATP binds to the NBD domain, the regulatory domain undergoes a conformational change and the channel gets open. Now once the channel is open, your chloride ion can pass. Okay, now what is the function? So it is found in the epithelial cells of many organs, including the liver, pancreas, digestive tract, and the reproductive tracts of the males and females. So wherever mucus lining is there, or mucal lining is there, there you find your CFTR. Normally the protein allows movement of chloride out of an epithelial cell into the airway, surface liquid and mucus. Now see how exactly it is happening. So positively charged ions, that is your sodium ions, follow passively. So if in one side you have got increased level of Cl minus, so what happens, your Na plus will also move towards the Na and becomes NaCl. Now what is happening when it becomes a NaCl? It's a salt, right? So it increases the total electrolyte concentration in the mucus. Now, resulting in the movement of water out of the cell via osmosis. So what is happening? You have got the chloride channel open. Now you have got sufficient amount of Cl minus. This results in the bringing of the Na plus towards it. Now once you have got the NaCl in one side, so there is a change in the osmolarity of the fluid, right? So whenever you have got high concentration of solute one side, what happens? The water will be high in the other side and low this side, correct? So the water from high potential to low potential, it moves. So water is going to move in this direction. Now when water moves, what happens? The mucus is actually replaced. So this is how mucus is formed, and whatever is trapped to the mucus, it will be removed. And then again, the process goes on till the respiratory tract is functioning. Now when the mutation happens, that the CFTR is not able to function, what happens? This chloride ions are not coming. So Na plus Cl minus is not formed. Water will not come. So what will happen? The mucus gets deposited and top of it many, many, many others. So big thick layer of mucus comes over there. And because of which it is not able to function. Okay. Time is getting up actually. Okay. So now in this case, again, same thing, you have got two domains are there, ATP goes and binds. Now what happens, you can see that when there is a binding of ATP, you can see over here, ATP binding is there. What is happening? There is a change in your regulatory domain. Once there is a change, your chloride ion is able to pass through. Okay, this is just another figure so that it becomes very clear, like how exactly these membrane transporters are working. Now what happens when there is a mutation, and where exactly the mutation is happening? It is because of the deletion of phenylalanine. Okay, this is one of the amino acid which is getting deleted at 508 position on the protein. As a result, what happens? The protein does not fold normally, and then any misfolded or unfolded proteins are there, or unfolded proteins are there, they undergo protein degradation. Okay. Now who degrades protein? That is your proteasome. Please remember. Okay. So how does CFTR is not functioning? It is because of the deletion of the phenylalanine at the 508 position on the protein, because of which the protein does not fold properly and it is degraded. Okay, and now what degrades protein is the proteasome. So just remember for time being what is proteasome. We'll study in detail because it's a very big complex molecule which helps in the protein degradation. Okay, so this is how your looks like. So we have got the normal CFTR channel. You can see whenever there's ATP binding, your chloride ions can move. Now, whereas in this case, the protein is not folded properly, it is misfolded. So what will happen? The channel doesn't get open up and the mucus, you can see over here, it starts building up. Okay. Now, if you take the cross section of the arteries and veins, what you can see is in the case of normal, see how much gap is there. So very nicely, the air or the air passage can be there, right? Whenever this is functioning normally. Now, once you have the mutant case or mutant chloride channel, you can see the mucus is present. Okay, it's not functioning. See how much mucus is present and the passage becomes very narrow. And once you don't have a proper passage, it becomes very difficult to breathe in. Okay. So is it clear till now, guys? So till now we were talking about the CFTR and which comes under the ABC transporter. So under ABC, we studied that it has got the two transmembrane regions. Each transmembrane region is made up of six alpha helices and it has got two nucleotide binding domains. Which nucleotide it binds? It is the ATP. I'm keep on repeating so that you also memorize with me. Now, under ABC, we learned about two types of examples. One was multi-drug resistance, which is present in all the phyla. Second is the CFTR, okay, cystic fibrosis conductance regulator. So this is important because, as I mentioned, the mutation, if it is in the recessive condition, the genetics part, then only the person suffers. Otherwise, if it is in the heterozygous condition, then it can live normal. So now next topic is our bacteriorhodopsin. Okay. So if you see the figure over here, can you see bacteriorhodopsin? You can see that the photons are actually acting over here. What are photons? Anyone? They are the energy packets. That is, when light falls on any receptor. So what happens? These packets of energy, the photons are actually taken up and used to convert your light energy into electrical or chemical energy. Okay. So depending on the function of the receptor, the light will be converted into electrical or chemical energy. So let's talk about bacteriorhodopsin. So from the name itself, it's clear that it is present in the bacteria. So it is found in archaea, halobacteria, as 2D crystalline 0.5 micrometer wide patches known as purple membrane. Okay. Now why it is purple membrane? Because when you visualize using the microscope, you can see them that their membrane has got these patches. Okay. Now these patches means these receptors are present over there. Now, it's a light driven integral membrane proton pump. It's a light driven. It means what? It is not depending on any other energy, but depends on the light. So light is falling on them, right? In the form of H nu. What is H nu? The energy packet, where H is the Planck's constant, nu is the frequency of light. Okay. So it is a light driven integral membrane. So it is present like this, integral membrane proton pump. So it means it is going to pump your H plus. Okay. Now it has got lambda max of 568 nanometer, containing a bundle of seven helices and an attached chromophore. So what is the chromophore over here? It is the vitamin A aldehyde called retinal. So see, in one sentence, so much information is given. So what do you mean by lambda max? It means that whenever you take any fluorescence of a molecule, okay. So suppose this is the wavelength in nanometer and this is the frequency. Okay. Now, if suppose you take any protein or nucleotide or sugar, whatever, any substance you take, it has always, it has got its some, the fluorescence is present, okay? So it is the fluorescence intensity, not frequency, sorry. It is the fluorescence intensity. Now, if I excite the molecule with the light, what happens is it gives certain amount of fluorescence, okay? Like this. You will get a graph of like this. Now, when I say that it is having the lambda max of 568 nanometer, it means that the maximum is 568 nanometer over here. It means what? It falls in the visible spectrum. 400 to 700 nanometer of your electromagnetic spectrum. Okay. Am I clear over here? Should I repeat once again? So it's a light driven. It means it is going to use the photons. Okay. H is the Planck's constant. Mu is the frequency. It is an integral membrane protein. So on a membrane, it has to be present like this. Proton pump, it means it is dealing with the H plus, having the lambda max of 568. So on a graph, if this is the wavelength and this is the fluorescence, so maximum is your 568 nanometer where it is going to fluoresce. Okay. Then it has got 7 hydrophobic helices and an attached chromophore. Now this chromophore is responsible for the absorption of light. Okay. Now, what is the name of the chromophore? It is your retinal, which is nothing but your vitamin A aldehyde. Please remember this three sentence is very, very important about bacterial rhodopsin. Now, as I mentioned, it acts as proton pump. It captures light and uses it to move the proton across the membrane out of the cell. Okay. So here what it is doing, it is using light energy to transport H plus from one side to the other side, and thus resulting in a proton gradient, which is converted into chemical energy. Clear? So this slide is very, very important. Read once again, okay? Yes. So let's see the structure of bacterial rhodopsin over here. Have you heard of rhodopsin alone? So in the eye, it is present. It's a protein, right? So when we deal about the human eye, will talk about the rhodopsin over there. So it is a GPCR also. We will come to that. Now, so see in the figure. So as already mentioned that it is a 7 helices. It has got the 7 helices are there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. Okay. Now you have got the, so these red color balls are water molecules. These are water molecules. And these are your lipids. Now, why lipids you are seeing? Because it's an integral protein. So it is embedded into the plasma membrane. So lipids will be present, correct? Now, you have got the chromophore. Can you see the chromophore over here? This is your chromophore. Here also, this is your chromophore. So this is the side view. This is the top view. Okay. Now, what happens is when the light has been taken by the retinal. So there is a conformational change in the retinal and this will allow the opening of the channel. Okay. So we'll go slowly, slowly only. So you have got the 7 hydrophobic, 7 helices are there. Okay. Now you see these lipid molecules because it is an integral protein, right? It's a transmembrane protein. Then you have got a chromophore. This chromophore, this is nothing but your retinal. You can see that the retinal is placed like this, right? So if this is your rhodopsin over you, retinal is present like this. So when it undergoes a conformational change, when the light falls on it, so what happens? The channel gets open up and then your H plus can move. Okay. Now, what you have to remember here is that the retinal molecule is actually covalently linked to your lysine 216 in the chromophore when absorbs light. Can you see? So here, this is your retinal, and to the protein it is attached to lysine 216. Okay. So there is a double bond between your 13 and 14 actually it is. Sorry. So the double bond is present between the 13 and 14. It changes its conformational from trans to cis. Can you see the change over here? So what is happening? You have got a double bond between 13th and 14th carbon. So whenever light falls on this, the double bond changes its conformational from trans to cis. So what is happening because of that? You can see the change over here, right? So the entire structure of the retinal gets changes over here. What is important to remember here is that at the end of this, a proton is donated to aspartic 85. So can you see from the So when there is a conformational change over here from trans to cis, what is happening? The lysine molecule, the H plus is there, right? Now this H plus has been taken up by the aspartic acid. Okay, and then it is moves to the periplasmic space. Now when the reprotonation happens, that means what? Again, it is going to regain the H plus. It will take the H plus from the cytoplasm. It will go to the aspartic 96. And from here, it goes back to the retinal. So what is happening? Then again, from cis, it goes back to trans. Is it clear to everyone? Or should I repeat? Is it clear? Then only I'll move ahead. Yes, anyone? Ranjan, it is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. See, the thing is, these are very complicated things. That's why I have to repeat again and again. So that, you know, once you understand, you can remember very well then. So I'll just say once again. So you have got a retinal molecule. So we know this is a chromophore. Okay. So this retinal molecule is attached to lysine 216 of the protein. So whenever it absorbs the light, this all trans retinal undergoes from trans to cis configuration. Okay, this is 13 to 14th carbon. Now during this process, what happens is that when this conformation change is there, the H plus is taken up by the aspartic 85 and this H plus is given to the XSLR. Now the retinal has to come back to its original position, right? Original configuration. So the protein will take the H plus from the cytoplasm and give it to the aspartic 96. And then this will give back to the cis configuration to become trans. That's it. Okay. So this is what is how the H plus has been transferred. So from your cytoplasm, it goes to the aspartic 96, then to the retinal, then to the aspartic 85, and then to the extracellular. So you see how the H plus has been transferred. Okay. Now this is another figure. Now, since it acts as proton pump, so it uses the energy to move the protons, right? So till now, we have seen that how exactly the proton has been transferred. So energy was taken, right? And then from the cytosol, it goes to the aspartic 96. From 96, it goes to the retinal, retinal to aspartic 85, and then to the outer space. Now, this was all about bacteriorhodopsin. Now what happens is you have got the H plus ATPase. Now this proton gradient is there. So what did happen open here? There was increased concentration of H plus and here less concentration. So a gradient, proton gradient has been formed. Now this H plus will move through the H plus ATPase. So what is happening? During this, ATP is synthesized. Okay, so got it how bacterial rhodopsin is converting your light energy into chemical energy. So what is chemical energy over here? Synthesis of ATP. Okay, now if I ask you the same question, what happens in the case of photosynthesis? In the case of photosynthesis also, light is taken, correct? And at the end of the day, what we get is ATP molecule. But over there, the mechanism is different. There, we don't have any rhodopsin molecule. There, the entire mechanism is different, which is carried out in the chloroplast. So the bacteria, which doesn't use ATP from the other sources, they synthesize using the light only, using bacteria rhodopsin. Am I clear over here? This is the last figure, same thing. So you have got the bacteria. Bacterial rhodopsin is there, which takes up the energy, puts the H plus concentration over here, and then you have got the ATP synthase, which will give you the ATP synthesis. And these are present on the inner membrane over here, right? So these invaginations are nothing but mesosomes, which are present in the bacteria. Now, what is the function of mesosomes? To increase the surface area of the bacteria and also to carry out respiratory actions. So what is the respiratory actions of the bacteria? So such kind of things like generation of ATP, you know, move passage of molecules from here and there. Yes. So any doubts over here? Yeah, so I would like to stop here. I hope the concepts are very much clear to all of you. So if any doubts are there, I'm always available. You can comment to me or you can write to us on excelsureacademy1220@gmail.com. If you really like the video, the content we are taking for the exam preparation, please share and subscribe. Let others also know. Let them also join. So all comments and suggestions are appreciated and are welcome. You can also give your own topic of your interest also in which the concepts are not clear to you. You can just comment us and we can make special videos on that. So keep watching and make your concepts clear. So let us crack this exam this time with full all enthusiasm. Thank you.